And now, live across this big, brown, flat, mysterious, crazy country, it's Martin Malloy with McMalloy and Tony Martin.
And today, this is not a recording. It's us live in person, wacky on peanut butter, rested, rejuvenated, looking for all the world like the supposedly newly hip Air Supply, but nowhere as funny. Also today, we're back with our brand new competition that pits you against a life-size replica of our federal opposition leader as we play Beat the Beasley. Plus, celebrity brouhahas. We'll examine those little incidents involving Adriana Exanides and Jeremy Sims. We'll launch our controversial new aftershave, and on Radio Gladiators, we'll take the plunge into Australia's brand new $75 billion hole. We'll hook up with those stranded cosmonauts, and joining us live, who else but Judith Lucy. Yes, it's all coming up on the program that's been taking a good, long, hard look at itself and asking, what did its parents do to deserve this? Martin Malloy. Have a little faith, and this is not a recording. It's Martin Malloy back in the studio with myself, Tony Martin, right around Australia with this bloke here, a man whose spectacular holiday estate on the Gold Coast was described by weekend guest Peter Costello as a $75 billion hole. Mick Malloy,
it's just like a big unibomber shed. That's what it is. Well, it's huge. It's the biggest one you've ever seen.
Okay. We've had 2 weeks off and we're already talking about the unibomber. That's good to see. Let's talk about what we got up to on the break, Mickey. All I can say is that I took the opportunity to do something I haven't done for about a year, and that's get out into the backyard with tools and just take to it. Just let the backyard know who's boss. And it's a sign that it's time to mow the lawns when you have to use a machete to get to the hell's hoist. Right. So I remedied that problem with a bit of napalm and a bit of Australian peanut butter. I can't really talk about my other activities over the break, Mickey, because it's going to court, and Adriana has requested that we just keep it, off the show.
So. As long as you've got a couple of sneaky ones in, buddy.
I can't say too much.
All right, we'll leave it at that.
What did you get up to?
Mate, I had one of the best holidays I've ever had in my life. Yeah. I went up to a region in this country called the Kimberley. Are you aware of it? Up the top, not the pointy bit, the other kind of bit.
Yeah.
Up the top of Western Australia there. And this is God's country. Yeah. No, this country predates God.
Does it really?
It was around before God. When God got here, he went, hey, I'd have a look at this. I'm going to call it the Kimberley.
Top night.
It really is. And I went on, I spent my time on this, it's a cattle station called Elquestra.
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 That's an Australian cattle station.
Yeah.
It's called Elquestra. What's going on?
Well, what happened there was two guys who made the claim on the land came up with a Spanish name. This is, I think, back in the 60s.
Yeah.
And anyway, went into town to register it and hit the source.
Oh,
by the time, it's true. And by the time they got to the office, all I knew was it was something Spanish. So they've gone Elquestra.
Yeah.
And it means nothing.
It doesn't really.
It means absolutely nothing. It's a 1 million acre cattle station, which is a fair size.
Mm.
Putting the bins out can take about 3 days or so, but on the upside, you can play the stereo fairly loud at night and not get any complaints from the neighbours. Yeah,
sure.
It's prehistoric tone. The bloke who manages it calls it Jurassic Park, which I thought was pretty funny till he woke me up the next morning toting a spear and asking me if I wanted to go and bag a woolly mammoth. I'm sitting there thinking, I don't remember seeing that in the brochure, Michael. But anyway, we've got up to all sorts of madcap tomfoolery. Tony, you can walk the gorges, take a chopper ride, do some bird watching. How about this? Sit in a thermal spring that has its source in New Guinea. This is true.
Really?
I was sitting in it with this bloke called Michael Wall. He explained to me how they dyed the water in a spring in New Guinea, and after some time, the dye appeared in that particular water hole. That's a bit of background.
Is that legal?
I think so.
Do you need council approval?
You do, but he had all the correct authority to do so. And we just sat there for hours, Tane, kicking back and relaxing in a beautiful, bubbling thermal spring.
Oh, yes.
Although I did notice the bubbling stopped when he got out.
Gotcha.
Must remember to ask. Ask him
local
about that.
Custom of
there you go. We went fishing. It's the best barramundi fishing in the world. They actually queue up to get on the line. I spent most of the afternoon handing out numbers like you do in a deli. Don't stop your pushing, you naughty barramundi. There's plenty here for everyone. I caught a barramundi so big I thought it was two blokes in a barramundi suit. And here's a bit of advice. Don't go fishing with your girlfriend.
Oh,
because
really?
10 to 1, she's going to bag a bigger one than you.
Oh, well.
My girlfriend's pulled out a barramundi about 10 or 11, 11 pounds in the old scale. And I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, well, I've got a fighting fish on the line here. Pulled it out, and it's a baby barramundi about 8 inches long. And the guy, Dave's going, you better throw that back. And I'm going, no, in some restaurants, it's a real delicacy. In fact, you'll pay more.
You can put it up on one of them picture frames, you know, the log, the varnished in bit
it,
of a log.
That's the one I wrestled in. We cruised down one of the many beautiful rivers in a boat tone. Mm. I sat in the back in face paint, pretending we were on our way to see Colonel Kurtz.
Oh, yeah.
Some of the other passengers asked me to turn down the Doors music and repeatedly ignored me when I started shaking catatonically and screaming, never get out of the boat! Never get out of the boat! As I said, it was serene, beautiful countryside. I was tarnishing.
Yeah, love, exciting and new.
It goes on, Tone. At night, there's a great bar where the locals entertain the tourists with their own world. Unique blend of storytelling and bullshit. One local, a stockman named Buddy, entertains the gang by whipping cigarettes out of your mouth with a stock whip, and depending on how much alcohol has been consumed, is quite prepared to gar a bit of straw wedged between someone's butt cheeks.
Really?
And he had the crowd eating out of the palm of his hand until I took centre stage with a rolled up wet towel. Thankfully, the Royal Flying Doctor Service was on hand to airlift my victim out of there. Bit of straw still intact.
Oh, goodness.
This is the other bit. The last thing I want to say, Tone, the Aboriginal rock art.
Oh, yeah.
Went around, had a look, exceptional.
Yes.
We saw some amazing art, 700-800 years old. Mm. They looked a lot like early loonigs to me. And next to them, even older, some very early jokes dated between 20 and 40,000 years old, all of which we've done on this show, I'm afraid. Great holiday. Big thanks to the team. And, Tone, do you mind if from time to time I just regale you with a few more anecdotes from my time at El Cuestro? Because it's great fun. Maybe later in the show.
What happens every time you mention the words El Cuestro? Does that mean you get to go back next year?
Shall I say it again?
Can I say it?
You can say whatever you like.
El Cuestro.
El Cuestro, El Cuestro, El Cuestro.
Well, look,
I'm on my way now.
enough of that, because, Mickey, we're back here to do a job. Mm. And it's time to kick off another season of Martin Malloy. Mm. And I figured we needed a new jingle for the show mid-year. And I've had the Martin Malloy singers out the back nutting something out. It sounds a bit insulting to me, but see what you think.
If you want to hear some dickheads crapping on, if you want to hear that f***ing Boyzone song, if you want to shit your neighbours, listen to Martin Malloy. Loads of pointless competitions, we've got them. Lots of juvenile noises, we've got them. And for technical malfunction, tune in to Martin Malloy. It sucks, it's Martin Malloy.
Sweet dreams of a rhythm and dance.
I think.
Do we get anything for that?
We need some retooling on the jingle, I'm afraid. Now, listen, I should just point out that El Cuestro business, I was joking. We're not getting free holidays out of this show. You know, you often hear about radio shows where, you know, a couple of blokes host it, and every time they meet.
Thanks to our good friends, Jennings Holmes.
And then they're just loading up the boot of the car with free stuff. Well, I'm proud to say that in the entire time we've been doing this program, the only free stuff I've accepted, apart from 700 T-shirts with the station name on, I think three packets of M&Ms, about five CDs, all of which were by The Real McCoy, I think, if I remember.
And any time a new brand of flavoured milk comes out, there's usually a crate of those on the doorstep.
And the South Island of New Zealand. I think I mentioned it a couple of
That's
times.
That's yours now,
and,
is it?
They handed over the deeds. So apart from that, we're totally clean. Back to business, and what's going on up in space, Mickey?
Some very interesting news, Tone. A couple of Russian cosmonauts have been stranded. They've been up there since Feb in that Mir space station.
Oh, yeah.
Mir. Space station called Mir. A lot of thought's gone into that, hasn't it? Everyone's thought, oh, what the hell, it's in space. Who cares? Call it what you like. Call it El Cuestro. It doesn't matter.
It's their further away one.
Absolutely.
It's when you want some real solitude with a couple of Russian blokes.
Correct. Mm. They were due to be flown home in about a month's time, but, well, the Russians have dropped them a line, sent them a fax, whatever they do, and said, sorry, slight hiccup. We've had a big week weekend down here, running out of cash. You're going to have to hang around for another 40 days while the boys do a bit of a whip around.
Oh, dear.
Now, that'd be a real piss-off, wouldn't it? I don't know about you, but I get a bit testy waiting for a cab.
Yeah.
Imagine having to wait 40 days for a lift. The guy driving that Soyuz rocket sent to get them is going to get a bit of a bake, I reckon, when he eventually fronts up. Mm. He's going to have a couple of very grumpy cosmonauts in the back seat. That'll be a very quiet trip home, I imagine. Kids, just imagine this. Mum says, OK, I'll pick you up after school. Then, for some reason, doesn't show for 40 days. You'd have to say something, wouldn't you? You'd get in that car, going, just don't say a word and drive. Oh, and Mum, I don't want to hear a word out of you about eating my greens, because I'm just not in the mood right now. Remember me, Mum? Remember me? I'm surprised you recognise me. I'm shaving now. My voice is broken. Look, my pants don't fit. You wouldn't be happy.
No,
well, that's what those cosmonauts will be thinking, because they'd already be packed.
Mm.
They would have done a quick tidy up round the moor, taken their perishables out of the fridge, put the cat out, left the light on to deter any potential thieves, only to be told we can't find the keys to the rocket and we can't afford any fuel. A couple of the lads are over at NASA siphoning a few tanks. We'll let you know how we go. Another 40 days on Moor. Yeah. You'd already be sick of the sight of it, wouldn't you? Sure, would have looked like a bit of a bachelor pad when you got there, but three blokes living there for 8 months. Right now, I reckon it's looking like that house from The Young Ones. Someone would have drawn a line down the middle of the room. Keep on your side. There'd be a huge pile of unwashed dishes in the sink. Out the front door, there'd be a large box of empty beer bottles. And when someone finally does arrive and knocks on the door, they'll all be kicking back on the couch watching Midday going, mate, you better get that. Oh, it'll be for you. Mate, I got it last time. You're closer. Well, I can't go. I'm in my jocks. Shh. Everyone, if we're quiet, they'll think nobody's here. Turn the telly down.
Radio Gladiators is coming up. Call us.
Lasting love, that's you too, here at Martin Malloy.
Hey, gents, are you sick and tired of being a nice guy? A good egg who most people generally have a kind word to say about? Yes? Then you can change all that simply by changing your aftershave to the new scent of Costello. While most aftershaves give men a certain degree of confidence, this pungent odour goes one step further and turns you into an arrogant prick. Just splash it on and we guarantee when you walk into any room, heads will turn and stomachs will churn as people get a whiff and go, "Phew, who's that smarmy bastard?" Costello is the unique essence of our federal treasurer captured in a bottle. Anyone caught downwind of a bloke wearing Costello will more than likely go the heave, creating another unique smell remarkably similar to the one we're peddling. Whether you're negotiating a workplace agreement, wrestling with a budget blowout, or merely feel like giving people the right royal shits wherever you go, Costello is the fragrance that will blind you from the growing tide of public dissatisfaction created by your superior demeanour and arse-like qualities. Apart from deadly sarin gas, Costello is the only odour banned outright on the Tokyo subway. And even though we advertise the price as $49.95, don't be surprised to find a few hidden costs and tariffs. Not a tax, a tariff. So for an aftershave that's on the nose, don't look any further than Costello. It's your mandate to make other people go.
Doesn't lie here at Martin Malloy. And it's us, so I just have to keep pointing this out. People might just be tuning in and thinking it's one of them recorded best-ofs. And what was on those best-ofs last week?
I have no idea. Go on.
No, I just remembered something that was. Was it our interview with Bert Ward? Did we play that, Gracie?
Yeah.
Bert Ward, Robin. And we leave in the bit about a bat sandwich, about him and Adam West getting into a bat sandwich. That wasn't cut out? Okay.
Made the best of.
I forgot about that. But here's the good news. This week sometime, we're going to get the other side of that story. We're going to be talking to the other half of the sandwich. Adam West.
Hurrah!
Batman
himself is going to be joining us here live on the panel here at Martin Malloy.
That's a coup.
It certainly
is. That's a coup in any book.
We've been negotiating for some time, but and I'm not joking.
Money has changed hands, people.
All right, but let's put that behind us, because on today's program, Judith Lucy's going to be with us. We've got Radio Gladiators coming up. We're going to take a long look into the hole, the $75 billion hole that we've been hearing so much about. But the big news in the next hour, we're going to be launching Beat the Beasley. What is Beat the Beasley, Mickey?
Oh, you don't want me to explain this, do you? I couldn't explain Moment of Truth. And that was a multiple choice question. You want me to explain Beat the Beasley?
Give too much away. Keep a bit of mystery.
Well, basically, we're dropping something. I can't say too much.
We're dropping something big onto something small. And only you can stop it. I think you get the idea. Now, here's some news which caught my attention over the weekend, Mickey. Adriana Gate, have you been following this?
I have indeed.
An ANSET flight attendant has been stood down pending federal police investigations into an alleged physical incident. There's a bloke in a suit looking through the glass. Don't forget to say alleged. That's alleged physical incident between herself and leggy Channel 7 personality and Wheel of Fortune hostess Adriana Exanides. Now, have you been following this, Mickey? Because
headlines. I've caught headlines.
Well, the incident allegedly occurred at Melbourne's alleged airport, Tullamarine, last Wednesday afternoon. We don't know too much about it, about the incident, except that it contains a P, a Z, and four vowels. That's all we know at this stage. But I suppose it'd be okay for us to hazard a guess, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I'll just have a look. Can we do that? Can we hazard it? We can hazard a guess. We can officially hazard a guess as to what happened out there at the airport. Could it have been a disgruntled viewer, angry with baby John Burgess's refusal to grow back the mo? I know, you know, that's got a lot of people that I know very worked up.
I would have got one in.
there's been a lot of speculation in the press that Burjo and Adriana are going to be replaced on Wheel. Now, maybe Adriana went off when someone at the airport suggested that in future, instead of her glamorously turning the letters on the show, they're going to get in one of those electronic boards that they have at airports with arrival and departure times. You know the ones? Could that work? Let's see. Is the phrase, too many cooks spoil the broth? It just wouldn't be the same.
Not the same.
Or perhaps Adriana was attacked by someone who's been driven insane by that incessant Wheel of Fortune music. Oh, oh my God, there it is. There, turn it off. Somebody turn it off. Can you hear it, Mickey?
No, I can't.
You can't hear the music?
No.
It's eating into my brain.
Must find Adriana. Must incite alleged physical incident.
This is Martin Malloy, brought to you by Absolutely Nobody. It's been a decade of...
Yes, it's Martin Malloy, back from holidays and fully rejuvenated, as you can tell.
Fine.
Yes, Beat the Beasley is coming, but right now, remember this?
Radio Gladiators, your chance to represent your state and win fame, glory and fabulous prizes. Here's today's challenge.
Mick, what happens? We go on holiday for a couple of weeks and the economy just plunges down into the toilet.
What happened?
What's going on?
I have no idea. We take our eye off the ball and look what happened.
Peter Costello's come out of the back room and he's bent over and revealed in his pants a $75 billion hole. He's turned both the pockets out and he's got a $75 billion hole in one of them.
Where's that come from?
And diddly in the other.
Nothing. Squat.
Now, explain to me what a $75 billion hole actually is.
Well, I have no. All I've ever heard is we had an $8 billion deficit, and that brought down a government. Remember that? Down a government.
Yeah,
and then 5 minutes later, with a bit of creative accountancy and by shuffling a few bits of paper around, everyone, have to tighten a few belts. We've got a $75 billion hole.
Okay.
Where's that coming from? And how do you feel that?
Now we know nothing about economics, as you can probably tell, but obviously the $75 billion's gone somewhere. Somebody might have found it.
It's got to be lying around.
Remember in Melbourne? I think there was an incident.
Balaclava.
At the Balaclava railway station, they found a box with 200 grand in it. And then a few weeks later, somebody found another box with 200 grand. What I like is the empty one, the third one that got found.
Someone was making a claim.
Exactly. But is it like that? Is the 75 bill lying about on a street corner? Should we be keeping the eyes peeled?
It's down the back of someone's couch, Tone.
Okay.
I'm telling you now.
So the question we're asking for today's radio Gladiators is, what would you do with $75 billion? Hmm. You've got $75 billion. It's in cash. What are you going to do with it? Now, we don't want to hear any of this world peace nonsense. This is Radio Gladiator.
This is your chance, people.
This is your chance to be real darn selfish and just say, what would you do with $75 billion?
Pay off some of my parking fines.
Oh, yeah.
Some. Yeah. Not all.
What about going to see the three tenors at the MCG next
Two
year?
Tickets, please. Two tickets, please. How about this? Just spend the whole lot on lolly snakes. Or I either get a lot or make them build one big one.
Oh, a real long one.
Walk in with a $75 billion and go, give me a lolly snake and a big one.
They'd have to have those reels like the Lifesavers have. They'd have six blokes rolling the thing up.
And you'd have to get like a team of guys on either end to stretch it. have to hook it up to the back of a truck.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. I'm sure there's a protocol to be observed.
Sure.
What about moving in next to Steve Vizard? I'm sure you can get close.
There's a possibility.
With 75 billion. What about behaving eccentrically? Would you get into that? Would you start going a bit Michael Jackson, wearing the mask and showing up in the sort of suit military air supply in concert style lapel kind of jackets?
Buying a llama.
that kind of thing.
That's what you do.
What about hiring the team from Twister, the special effects team, to help you win the top prize on Australia's Funniest Home Video by creating the most spectacular and unlikely wacky wedding video of all time? That's $75 billion well spent.
That'd be great. With a credit sequence at the end. What about, I'd think about purchasing KFC. And
reintroducing the bucket.
Bringing the bucket back.
$75 billion into the bucket. So that's something for the good of the community.
Sorry, Gracie. I'd repair this desk. That's what I'd do with $75 billion.
So, well, that's very admirable. And finally, here's something I wouldn't do if I had $75 billion. I'd make sure not to leave it in my jacket pocket when I cark it if them reports on the funeral industry are to be believed. We'll talk about ratting in an upcoming edition of the program. But right now, call us with what you'd do with $75 billion. And have we got a prize?
Yes, indeed. It's back, the three-pack of CDs, including Alanis Morissette, Jagged Little Pill, The Corrs, Forgiven Not Forgotten, and Hootie and the Blowfish, Fairweather Johnson.
They're a permanent fixture in the three-pack, aren't they?
They certainly are, and I've just popped out to the Fairweather Johnson myself during the ad break. Plus, you'll go into the drawer for, this Friday, Pete Smith himself reaching into the barrel to send somebody off to Bali, two people off to Bali for 5 nights staying at the hotel. I think it's pronounced Intan Legion, or is it?
Intan Legion.
I'm not sure.
I think it's Legion.
I don't know how it's pronounced, but I know that backwards it spells Nigel Natney, and that can't be bad. I think that's your lawyer, isn't
that's
it?
That's my lawyer.
Nigel Natney. And you'll
attorney
be
at law.
Flying Qantas, and of course, it's all thanks to our extremely good friends at Creative Holidays. Call us with your suggestions on what to spend $75 billion on. 1-800-657-657.
Hi, I'm the guy who says Martin Malloy. Call me on the new SAFM.
Radio, you can select which feature of the program you wish to enjoy. Today's selection is as follows. If you want to hear me telling you...
Cable TV channel Crap Tell, and just listen to these crap new shows. Following the success of Mick Molloy's Top Blokes and Superstars and Little Battlers and Top Sorts comes an all-new special. Mick Molloy's Top Blokey Green and Gold Super Types Down Under, Toppy Blokey Aussie Super Sorts, and Battlin' Blokey Aussie Hoopsy Bunsy Matey Super Larrikins, Fair Dinkum Fist Sinkin' Little Aussie Big Maxi No Worries Matey, How They Hang and Mega Blokes, and Good Sorts with Top Norgs. And that's followed by American situation comedy at its very best in My Two Annoying Dads. Jerry Seinfeld and Mad About You's Paul Reiser are together at last as two neurotic 30-something New Yorkers who just can't stop whining about everyday trivia.
What is the deal with airline food? I mean, those little packets are impossible to open. You think that's bad? What is the deal with valet parking? What, am I too stupid to park my own car? What is the deal with dry cleaning? What is the deal with 8 items or less? What is the deal with 5-day shampoo?
Come on, you guys, the building's on fire. You gotta get out of here. here.
What is the deal with the fire department? What is the deal with those hats they wear? I mean, is this a hat you would want to be seen in? What is the deal?
Finally, a radio station that picks me up and makes me feel good all day.
Here at Martin Malloy with Fast Love, and right now...
It's time to play Beat the Beasley. Here's how it works. Mick and Tony have commissioned the nation's finest designers, engineers and craftsmen to construct several frighteningly lifelike replicas of Federal Opposition Leader Kim Beazley. Every day on Martin Malloy, one of these enormous structures will be dropped onto something fragile, tiny or defenseless. That is, unless you can correctly answer five questions and beat the Beazley. If you're successful, you'll win a Beazley-proof watch valued at $1,500 from our extremely good friends at Michael Hill Jewelers. Okay, lads, roll out the Beazley.
Glad to, Pete. And,
Did he say roll out the Beazley?
He did.
Of course he did.
There's a name for the next album. But what we've done is we have constructed a massive Beazley today entirely from infected Australian peanut butter. It's a shocking sight. It's suspended from the ceiling, and I believe we're going to drop it onto something extremely valuable and fragile. What is it, Mickey?
It's Captain Cook's Diddy Box. It went missing this morning, funnily enough, from Captain Cook's cottage.
And we've got it here, haven't we?
We got it here. Do you know how I got it? We just dobbed ourselves in there. You know when you have one of those big nights and you wake up and you're in someone else's house and for a minute you're going, Jesus. Out, I get here. Well, that's it. You know, I'm in Captain Cook's bed in the cottage going, whoa, that was a big night. Seen the Diddy Box. Yeah. Thought, I'll have that. And we're out here.
And, of course, obviously, it's a valuable antique. You wouldn't want to see it splattered with peanut butter.
That would be a crime,
Tony. Okay, so we can prevent that happening by, getting someone from the general public to call us up and just answer a few old-fashioned radio trivia questions. Mm-hmm. You've got a minute. If you get five of them right, we don't. Drop the Beazley. It's as simple as that. And remember, keep this in mind. We are not professional radio quiz masters. The whole thing could turn ugly and go horribly, horribly wrong. Pete Smith's been doing his best. He's given us the Glen Ridge coaching tapes that he's put on while you're asleep. But they haven't been working.
Yeah. He's done everything he can possibly do. We're on our own now, Tony.
All right, so call us up and see if you can beat the Beazley. 1-800-657-657. Welcome back to Martin Malloy, where that music tells us it's time to beat the Beazley. Here's what we've done. We've constructed a giant replica of opposition leader Kim Beazley from infected Australian peanut butter. It's suspended, or it will be in a moment when Gracie winches it into position over an extremely rare and priceless oak chest which once belonged to Captain James Cook. And don't ask how we obtained it. We just did. And all you have to do is answer five questions correctly in the space of 1 minute. Is that how it works?
Sounds pretty simple to me. You'd think nothing could go wrong, wouldn't you?
Okay. For any other show, this would be a straightforward competition. We're making it up as we go along. When I say you, who am I talking about? Mickey.
You're talking about a young man named Chris. Hello, Chris.
Hi, Mick. Hi, Tony.
How are you?
Fine, thanks.
Congratulations on helping us lose the cherry here on Beat the Beazley.
All right.
There you go.
Now, you're not nervous, are you, Chris?
Oh, a fair bit, yeah.
It's pretty straightforward. We've hanging
not as nervous as us.
Exactly. See us in here. And we've hanging the balance is, of course, a Sector Sports watch, courtesy of our friends at Michael Hill Jewelers. It's worth $1,500. It must be a bloody good watch. That's all I can say. And you've got 1 minute. We're going to fire a whole bunch of questions at you. All you have to do is get five correct answers to stop us from dropping the Beazley.
Okay,
so winch the Beazley into position if you can, Gracie. Here it comes, made, as we say, from dangerously unstable Australian peanut butter. And if you can fire the gun and get things underway, Mr. Grace. Here we go. Question one, who is Kim Beazley?
He's the opposition leader of Australia.
Yes. Who is Otmar Liebert?
Otmar Liebert, wouldn't have a clue.
Oh, he's a classical guitarist. Question three, spell Mick's surname.
Mick Malloy.
You spell it.
M-O-L-L-O-Y.
Yes, so correct.
There you go. Name a sportsman currently appearing in a TV commercial. Must have own hair.
Steve Waugh.
There you go.
Indeed. Which film won the Academy Award for Best Picture last year?
Last year. Dunno.
Dunno is not the correct answer. It's Forrest Gump.
Which film won the AFI Award for Best Picture last year?
Dunno.
And we'll skip question seven. And who is the lead singer of Oasis?
Mr. Oasis.
I can't accept that. And we'll skip question nine too, I think. Oh, hang on.
Oh, no. The Beasley has been dropped. How many correct ones did he get there? Just the three. Oh, of course, the lead singer of Oasis is not Mr. Oasis. It's Liam Gallagher and Mika. Skip question nine, which was who's he shagging? Probably good, but don't worry about it, Chris, because you have got yourself a Martin Malloy T-shirt and Brown album.
Oh, no.
Yes, indeed. A typical response from a typical listener. Thanks for playing Beat the Beasley, Chris.
That's right.
And contributing to the tapestry of fun. Are we going to forge on with this idea?
We're going to try. That's people's encouragement to actually beat the Beasley.
You're copping a T-shirt.
Indeed. Well, we'll be back with more Beasley dropping tomorrow on Martin Malloy. Tip for the day, people, here at Martin Malloy. Brian Adams with the only thing that looks good on him is you. And time now for something which, well, we've had a few requests for this one. Haven't we?
Yep.
Okay. And quite a few from members of the animal kingdom.
Have a listen. If you only take your kids to see one film this year, make sure you take them to see Humpy, the touching story of a mischievous young canine who won't stop humping his master's leg.
Hey, Humpy, do you want to play fetch? Do you, Humpy? Oh, Jesus. See the stick? Go fetch. Humpy, go fetch. Or get off me, you creep.
When Humpy sees a window of opportunity for a bit of dry humping action, he just hooks onto his master's leg and goes like the clappers.
Morning, Mr. Johnson.
Morning, lad. What can I do for you?
I'll be needing some bait and a couple of hooks. Me and Humpy are going fishing.
You be careful out there in the woods today, son. We don't want any accidents.
Don't worry, Mr. Johnson. I've got Humpy to look after me.
But what if you're separated?
Yeah, right. Fat chance.
Well, there you go, son.
I might just wait till Humpy's finished.
I'll knock it off, will ya?
When a fairly predictable life-threatening disaster strikes down one half of our adventurous duo, only a highly excitable Humpy can save the day.
Humpy, I'm injured. My leg's trapped under the fallen tree. No, the other one, Humpy. Quick, go and get help. Humpy, go get help. Jesus, you shit me, Humpy!
With a precious life hanging in the balance, Humpy's not about to let his master out of his sight.
We'll have to operate immediately. Nurse, scalpel.
Scalpel.
Forceps.
Forceps.
Rolled up newspaper.
Rolled up newspaper.
Get out of it, Humpy, you mongrel! Get out of it!
We're losing him.
Quickly, stand clear. Stand clear. Humpy, would you bloody stand clear?
It's the feel-good movie of the year. Don't miss this heartwarming story of a dog's somewhat unhealthy and often embarrassing attachment to his master. Whatever you do, make sure you see Humpy, coming soon to a cinema near you.
Well, young man, we may have had to chop your leg off, but we saved your life.
Thanks, Doc. Would it be possible to see me old leg?
Certainly. It's just in here. Oh, Humpy!
Moon, that's Tina Arena winding up Martin Malloy. It's our first run back from the break. It's still beating itself in.
It is. It takes a while, doesn't it? For something as simple as this, you're dealing with a couple of knuckleheads.
Well, it'll be back to speed tomorrow, I'm sure. And have we forgotten to mention anything? Certainly Colonel Gaddafi has been up to no good. He's caused a fair deal of amusement at the first Arab summit in 6 years. He's broken a United Nations ban on flights from from Libya, because, of course, as we know, he's the only person who's not allowed to fly on airlines.
Oh, okay.
Him and Adriana Exanides, I think, allegedly. But anyway, he's flown to the summit, and he's then got up at the... he's refused to shake hands with Yasser Arafat, which is a bit of a no-no. Uh-huh. And then he's gone up and just bagged everybody. Bert Newton at the Logie style. He's just gone to town, and normally, as one leader said, if anybody else had said the things he did, there would have been a big problem, and I'm sure firearms would have been produced. But it's Gaddafi, and we all know Gaddafi.
He's so a card.
He's kind of like Don Rickles. He's just it's a, an Arab celebrity roast, and Gaddafi can get up and just bag people and get away with murder, and then he probably put on a cowboy hat and did the Libyan version of Australiana, dropped it, you know, an uncanny Frank Spencer, got gonged off by Red, and back he went on the plane.
That's how it works. He can get away with that. He wears a cape.
It's right.
You're not going to, you know, the guy wears a cape. You're not about to, you know, the rules are different.
So what's happening to Gaddafi? Are we going to see him on the cabaret circuit? He's wearing the cape. He's got the chicks in the camouflage gear. He's dropping gags.
I saw him in the cape. Do you know, and the latest photo I've seen, he's wearing a top hat, and he's got one of those false moustaches. And I've only heard this, but apparently he's been tying women to the railway tracks. I don't know what his caper is. What is he up to? He's gone mad.
Barking. Well, we'll keep you up to date on Mr. Gaddafi's behaviour. What about, I know certainly during Beat the Beasley, we were banding the words infected peanut butter about. But it's not something to be taken lightly. It's a serious old business. And I know about 55 odd people have been struck down.
Struck down with a bit of gastroenteritis.
Yeah, or what may well lead to that. Because I don't think they're all suffering the gastro.
Is that right?
Certainly. I haven't got the exact statistics.
Yeah, right.
It's Martin Malloy. You don't expect accuracy, do you?
Don't take us seriously, people. But don't listen to this for your news.
Is that taking your fancy,
Mickey? Yeah, I think there's about, so far, 12 brands or something that have been recalled, and they take it pretty seriously. Mind you, I don't think they need to recall the product. I reckon they can just replace a few labels. So when you're in the shop and you're going down the supermarket, you can see, you know, smoothie, crunchy, queasy. What about that?
Very nice.
But they're going to recall it and do their testing, and I just won't sure why. Find a way to test if your peanut butter's good or bad. Just wait till Madonna gets back from a date, and if she runs to the toilet, the peanut butter is bad.
Okay.
Bad.
Handy hints there. It's bad, not to be confused with mad. Now, thanks to our guests today, Judith Lucy, all our gladiators, and Chris, who almost beat the Beasley. We'll be back tomorrow with, listen to this, the inventor of the stack. The inventor of the Marshall amp, Jim Marshall himself, who's in Australia. So we'll see you tomorrow.
If you want to hear some dickheads crapping on, if you want to hear that f***ing Boyzone song, if you want to shit your neighbours, listen to Martin Malloy. Loads of pointless competitions, we've got them. Lots of juvenile noises, we've got them. And for technical malfunction, tune in to Martin.